There is a frustration in dealing with evangelical advocates of theistic evolution. Actually pinning a basis on them on which an argument can be built can prove elusive. This is because they belong to a churchmanship which doesn't do argument and doesn't do systematic theology. Instead of argument, we have conversation. And instead of systematic theology, we have narrative theology. So they become as slippery as eels, and trying to have a reasoned, rational argument with them is a bit like nailing jelly to a ceiling. Comments on theistic evolutionary websites, such as that of the Biologos Foundation, contain a mixture of dogmatism combined with a sort of liberalism in the broadest sense of that word. Articles state that any definition of the early chapters of Genesis as historic fact must be wrong. Literal readings of Genesis are asserted to be category errors, or an ignorance of the evidence. Then, when a countercase is made, contributors assert that we are not being good conversation partners, and that they're not being dogmatic, they're merely trying to open the conversation. Into this mess, a different approach is needed. It's the presuppositional approach. We start by assuming Genesis to be true. Why? Because it's in God's word, because the hermeneutics say that it should be so interpreted, and because Jesus and Peter and Paul clearly believed it to be true. So we assert that most major Christian doctrines depend on the truth of the early chapters of Genesis or find their origin there. In my book, No Time for Itching Ears, I've attempted to illustrate this truth. I've not examined every possible doctrine in the book. This is not a systematic theology, nor can it be said to be systematic on any individual doctrine. I have not traced all the doctrines through every part of the Bible, as I don't feel qualified to do so. What the book is, then, is an exercise in demonstration. I take a doctrine and I make the case for its truth, tracing some of its assertion through the New Testament and then through the Old. Finally, I look at how the justification of the doctrine rests on the truth of Genesis. For example, take the doctrine of the Trinity. Although the word itself famously doesn't appear in the Bible, it clearly exists in the New Testament. Passages supporting this thesis are examined. We then see that the doctrine of the Trinity also exists in the Old Testament. Finally, having made this biblical case, we see that the truth is also reflected in the words of Genesis itself. For example, in the words God created, in the Hebrew we have a plural word for God, which actually implies at least three, together with a verb that normally takes a singular subject. I wanted No Time for Itching Ears to be easy to read, so I've used humour wherever possible. I hope readers will not find this inappropriate. I've also contended for the truth of Scripture, which I've assumed throughout. It's when we assume the truth of the early chapters of Genesis that we find the whole of the Bible falling into place. It's exciting being a Christian when we realize that everything God said is exactly as He said it, that He did indeed say it. But it is humbling to realize that our job is not to stand in arrogant judgment over Scripture, but rather in humble submission to it, accepting, as Martin Luther put it, that the Holy Spirit, in inspiring Scripture, has more wisdom than we do.